All right, going through the 30 Days of Christmas special. These are stocking stuffers for you. And in this video, we are going to take a journey through the world of special effects, and we will do a commentary on those. So let us get going on our journey right away here. Go! Go, go, go. All right, so we're heading along in the world really fast, zipping through day after day, month after month, year after year, and life is like a blur to us, really. This is what it's like, isn't it? This is what it's been like as the pace of life has picked up in this world. It seems as though we're going along like this. We don't have time to stop and smell the roses. Why we're in, we have a destination we're trying to get to, right? Really fast. We want to get to that destination as fast as possible. So we're fixated on going through this road. We don't even know. We're not even aware of our surroundings and the deeper questions. And so, oh, suddenly we arrive. And what do we arrive at? The world of special effects, right? That's what we've been going towards so fast. The world has been going as fast as possible for this popcorn. All right. And as we get to look at this popcorn, what do we see? We see, it gradually dawns upon us that what it is we're seeing is something entirely superficial is what we're seeing. It gradually dawns on us. At first we imagine there's depth to it, but gradually dawns on us there is no depth to it. And we have this funny feeling as we're watching special effects that we're being conned. We have this funny feeling. Deep down we kind of know it. Of course we're in on it. We're conning ourselves. We're in on it. But we have this feeling like, this isn't it. We know it isn't it. And we kind of feel silly. A little feel silly and feel stupid for even paying attention to it. Because we know it's not it. And yet as it keeps coming at us like this, we say, oh, what's the next permutation? Oh, what's it going to be like right in a second from now? Oh, you see that? And we just don't want to stop watching because we don't know what's next. What is next? Well, actually, what's next is the same superficiality as what came before. It's just a different dress skeleton. The skeleton has a different dress on. Okay, that's the question. The question we're asking ourselves is, what is the skeleton going to wear next? And, okay, here's the skeleton wearing something different here. Okay, we say, oh, that's kind of a interesting skeleton. I like the way that skeleton is dressed up there. And then as it starts to wear off, we say, okay, where's the next skeleton? Oh, there's the next skeleton. Oh, the next skeleton is wearing that. And oh, there comes another skeleton. What's wearing that? It's like the fashion models going down the runway. What are they going to wear? What's the next fashion model going to be wearing? We see one and we say, oh, okay, that's interesting. Then and right away we start getting, that's bored. That just doesn't do that much for me. And then what's the next one? And they say, oh, yeah, that was interesting. Oh, there's another one, you see. Okay, here's another ensemble. And we're looking at this now. We're saying, and then we're starting to think, there's another one. Okay, maybe this will give me something that I want. Let's watch this for a little while. How's this going to play out? And we know the drill. We know the drill. Some of us have been down that road more than others. But we know the drill. And so we're watching, and we kind of know that, yeah, it's going to be kind of kaleidoscopic. But it doesn't really give us any depth at all. It doesn't give us what we really want. And some of us try to take drugs and hope that that'll work. And of course, but the fact is the drug itself feels superficial to us. And something deep within us goes, uh-oh, this is going to wear off. It's still superficial. It's not quite what I want. It's not quite what I want. And so they say, well, let me try a new drug. I need a new drug. I need a new special effects. I want to watch this, you know, in an altered state of something. And maybe that'll make it what I really want. And as we get more and more bored by these special effects, I mean, not that they're not ingenious. This is ingenious. This is some of the more beautiful special effects that are just available on Creative Commons on YouTube. And it's very well done. But it is what it is. It's simply special effects, right? It doesn't truly give us any depth at all. No matter what we do, no matter how we try to alter our perception, our experiencing of it, there's always this feeling in the background like, yeah, what's next? You know, what's next? Probably already thinking, okay, come on, give us the real stuff here. We're ready for the real stuff. Question is, do special effects or entertainment ever give us the real stuff? Do we ever get the real stuff? Have we gotten it yet? No. Well, we've had an awful lot of the special effects and entertainment come down the road. And yet, none of it's been it. It's never been it. Some of us believe that if we just watch it nonstop, it will become it. Try that. I used to do that. And, you know, if we watch it 16 hours a day, that will super saturate us and it'll become it. You can try it if you want to. But it doesn't. It doesn't become it. It doesn't work. Just like music, we can saturate our lives with music. And that still isn't it. We can try music with these special effects, with the drugs, etc., etc. That isn't it. And we get a little worried. We say, I'm having problems finding what it is. And of course, there's lots of people in the world who pretend that they found it, and then they become these celebrities. Celebrity smiles and says, yeah, I found it. I found it. A lot of people know if they just say they found it, everybody will flock to their door and say, wow, you're saying you found it. But did they really find it? You can tell. And if you want to be deceived, you won't even look at them. You'll just take their word for it. You won't even look. Now, there are a few that have found it. And to them, you can look and you can see it. You can tell. You can feel it. You're aware of it. Wow, they really have found it. Because you're truly paying attention to see if that's the case or not. But for those who haven't found it, of course, if you look, you'll see that they haven't found it. And then you go, oh, no, what's next? You mean I got to keep looking? Yeah, you got to keep looking. And you got to keep going down that road. And after we pass through the special effects, what's going to be next? What are we on the road to now is the question. What are we on the road to now? We should be on the road to salvation, which is the recognition that this all of existence is merely a hypothetical scenario projected into an imaginary future where we are trying to learn how to adapt to the presumed changed reality, the presumption of a changed reality. And that this changed reality has taken on a very weird aspect. It's very weird. And yet we believe that this is life, that this is reality now. And we have to learn how to adapt to it. That is what existence is. We're trying to learn to adapt and love a very bizarre, changed reality. And we can never do that. We can never do it. It's all meaningless. Why? Because reality is never going to change. It is never going to change. It's only we presume that it would change. So we're on a road. The way we're continuing to go, we're on a road to nowhere. A dead end, actually. A dead end. As long as we continue down this road unaware, in such a haste that we don't even ask these questions. Where are we going? Why are we going? Why are we in such a hurry to get results? We don't even ask these questions. What do we hope the results to give us? Has results ever given us what we really want? See the context. See the situation. Be aware of it and ask these questions. And then we'll say, hey, wait a minute. Maybe we need to get off this road. Maybe we don't need to get anywhere in existence. Maybe we don't need to get anywhere. Maybe we don't need to do anything in existence. Maybe we don't have to wait for any results to take place. Why? Because reality is never going to be changed. So we don't need to learn to adapt to a changed reality. Because reality will never change. Reality still is exactly the way it's always been, and we are included in that reality, and we can function perfectly there. And all these lessons we're supposedly learning on this long journey to nowhere are completely useless, meaningless, no application in reality to us whatsoever. So we don't need to keep on going down that road. We don't have to keep going down that road at all. This is the good news of salvation. And right, we don't even need another minute, another second, another instant of waiting for effects. We can choose to experience the overlay, the overlay, the overlay. It overlays all of the universe simultaneously and helps us realize that we don't need any results whatsoever. This overlay is not generating any results. It is simply quietly abiding. Perfect, gentle, quiet abidance. And we just enjoy that, abide in that perfect abidance, gentle abidance. And we say, ah, the world of effects and results no longer has any interest in me. No relevance whatsoever. No meaning. It's meaningless. And in its place, I'm experiencing this wonderful, wonderful, peaceful, tranquil, calm, gentle, exquisite overlay. That is what is waiting for us when we start asking these questions, get oriented in the right direction, and decide that that is the answer. That is what is true. That is the true path to salvation. And stop hurriedly, frantically chasing after results in existence. Waste of time. Total waste of time. All right. Very great. This has been another stocking stuffer on this 30 Days of Christmas program, counting down the days to Christmas. And what happens at Christmas, around Christmas? Well, we'll find out, won't we? In the meantime, get clear about this context. Get clear about it. Get clear about it. Make your final considerations about the world and what it's really about and whether or not you really need to keep waiting for the effects and the results of this world or not. Okay, very great. That's it for this one. In this next vignette, we are going to explore a topic that is dear to my heart, and that is how actors and actresses in the entertainment industry have been used like Pied Pipers to lead the world down a dead-end path, using their antics to amuse us. And we feel like, oh, we need to follow the entertainment. Follow, where is the entertainment going? Let's follow along with that. And as we're following along with that, we're getting herded in, herded more and more and more and more and more into this dead end. All the while kind of giggling and laughing at the antics as the herders herd us into that area that they want us to go, which is really a dead end. So we're going to use, to illustrate this, we're going to use my favorite actor, Jim Carrey, he's actually my alter ego. If I wasn't doing this, I'd be like Jim Carrey. But this is more important because actors really and actresses don't really know anything about salvation. They are truly ignorant of it, terribly ignorant of it, because they're used to getting attention through their antics and people laughing at them. They say, hey, this is fun. But maybe Jim Carrey is actually starting to get it. He's starting to pay attention to Eckhart Tolle, talking about the eternal now, and it's maybe something starting to click with him. I hope so, because he's as a comedian's go, he's just absolutely fabulous. So I have this Creative Commons clip. I'm going to show it to you, and then we'll talk a little bit more after this clip. We'll join the clip in progress, and we'll look at some of his antics, etc., and then we'll discuss a little bit more about actors and actresses in the entertainment industry and why we should not pay any attention to them really at this time. Here we go. Jim Carrey and his antics.
How he and his Better You Foundation could help the Caribbean nation still suffering more than a year after the quake. He came to this school in Port-au-Prince, where the World Food Program makes sure kids get a good, healthy, nutritious meal every day. Seeing so many children still without permanent homes, Jim Carrey was reminded of a tough time when he was growing up.
I remember when I was homeless for a little while growing up, and it was extremely difficult for me to learn, and especially when you're hungry. When you're hungry, you can't learn. You know, so the basics are, you know, food and shelter, food and shelter. If you get that, then you can start to soar to new heights in all the other areas. But these kids gotta eat.
And he liked what he saw. The school has some 1,400 children. They learn in three shifts, from morning until 8 at night. Jim Carrey was so impressed by the combination of education and school meals that he immediately promised to partner with WFP and provide meals for all the children for the entire school year. And he got emotional when we asked him about seeing these Haitian children, given that he is a father himself.
Oh, it's an extra level of depth, for sure, when I look at these kids. I mean, it's hard for me to talk about it even, because I start thinking about my own daughter and my grandson now, and what wouldn't we do for them?
And he admitted that he does not feel like an adult sometimes. And yes, he proved it. The kids might not have known who that funny, tall guy was, but after a little while, they were his newest fans. Bettina Lucia, World Food Programme, Port-au-Prince. He is known as a very funny man, but Jim Carrey means business when he talks about eliminating hunger.
25 cents a day, $50 a year to feed a child in a school, 3 square meals a day, to get them here, to have them have a purpose and place to be, and a shot at improving their lives.
He visited Haiti.
All right. There you go, Jim Carrey. Very funny guy, very, very good guy, and he's doing something really great, helping feed people who don't have food, which is a fine thing to do. But it doesn't have anything to do with salvation. The question is, why are there people, why is there scarcity in the first place? Why are we in a situation of vulnerability to scarcity? How can we be saved from this truly? And the answer comes from those who have studied this and focused on this as their life's vocation instead of entertaining others. Entertaining others is a lower type of vocation, but right now in the world, things are upside down, and the world is taking its cues from the entertainers. Even who to vote for president and elective office, etc., they take cues from entertainers. Entertaining is amusing, amuses us, but it's a very low vocation. It doesn't really, it's not focusing on our salvation from this wretched situation we call existence, the world, where look at Haiti and the terrible, terrible devastation and crisis that hit Haiti. And you have to ask, why is that even possible to happen? How is that even possible that this could happen? Where are we? What is this place? What's going on here? What is the purpose? Those are fundamental questions that our educational system doesn't answer. And there's far too few people in the world who can answer those questions. And you probably won't see them out there entertaining so much, because this is a very serious, difficult career path, a path to take to get those answers. And we won't find those answers in the antics. The answers are not in the antics. Although those who do have the answers can occasionally engage in antics, that perhaps is okay as well. But the antics are not primary. What is primary is the explanation that existence is actually a hypothetical scenario that we are imagining as a projection into an imaginary future where we are trying to fix, adapt to a problem that we believe, whimsically believe, is going to actually happen to reality, that reality is going to be changed. And we're trying to adapt ahead of time to this changed reality, even though it hasn't happened yet. It's kind of like, let's say that we were perfectly healthy and we had this whimsical notion that someday we're going to get a deadly illness. And so we start dedicating our entire life's effort to developing a pill, a medication that can cure this extremely deadly illness. And we spend just unbelievable efforts designing this super sophisticated pill. But the fact is that this deadly illness will never occur to us, will never happen to us, because we are invulnerable. We can never be sick. So it's completely, a total waste of time. That is what existence is. And that is what the entertainers will probably never tell you. So don't wait around for the entertainers to be explaining anything of importance to you, and try to minimize your exposure to them. Here's just a short little clip I used here. And maybe even Jim someday will say, hey, thanks for using that clip. That may be possible. Who knows? He seems to have some sort of developing awareness. I hope so, because he truly is a great guy and a very funny guy. But again, limit your exposure to the whole entertainment industry as much as possible, and pay no attention to their pronouncements and who they support and everything else, really. It's a waste of time, because right now it's super important we pay attention to what is the right path to salvation? That's all important because of the various crises that are coming up. All right, this is another 30 Days of Christmas vignette gift. Let's talk a little bit about the overlay. Ramana Maharshi used to advise those who came to him, if they wanted to take care of all of the thorns and stickers and rough stones that hurt their feet, simply wear a pair of shoes instead of trying to pick all of those stickers and thorns up. He was referring to the overlay as the sovereign remedy. In this short video, we are going to actually take a look at a symbolic overlay in the streets of Dhaka, Bangladesh, to just give you a sense of, just a very faint sense of an overlay. Okay, so let's take a look at this amazing video here. The street here has been overlaid with this artwork. Imagine if the entire world was overlaid with something exquisite and something beautiful, something with actual depth instead of the superficiality of all the high-tech special effects of this day and age and all the gadgetry. It gives us all this play of light, but it's entirely superficial. But imagine an overlay over not only this entire planet, but the entire universe is overlaid with some incredibly beautiful, seamless, peaceful effect. That's called the overlay, and it is overlaid with that. It's simply that we have to have the eyes to see it, the vision to see it. It cannot be perceived perceptually. There's a spiritual eye that can perceive it, and it is there actually for us to perceive. Let's take another look at this overlay. This is part of the 30-day countdown to Christmas series, and I'll just be making little vignettes and maybe stringing them together for you, which is just the gifts of Christmas, the apocalypse, the unveiling of gifts. We are in the apocalyptic times now, which means that which was before obscure and somewhat hidden is now becomes unveiled. So we're using just this very cute example of street artwork in Dhaka to illustrate the awesomeness of the overlay, which is really our salvation. Experiencing the overlay is what we'll experience when we decide to stop trying to figure out the remedy for a hypothetical problem, a problem which is actually never going to arise in reality whatsoever. When we decide to give that up, the vision of the overlay will arise in us, and we will be seeing this exquisite overlay over the entire universe. All right, that's it for this one. Thank you. does existence seem, feel as if it were some sort of dream? And why? Why does it seem to feel that way? The answer is because it is a dream. We give it not. We are dreaming this dream of existence, only the dreamer is not in the dream. The dreamer is symbolizing something in the dream. What is this dream symbolizing, is the question. The answer is very simple. This dream arose for the purpose of symbolizing, modeling the notion of a changed reality. The notion that reality is going to change. We had this whimsical notion that reality can be changed and it's going to change and it no longer will be what it is. It'll be something entirely different. So we're imagining a different reality, a reality entirely different than what reality really is. And we're imagining ourselves living in this reality, this new reality, adapting to it, learning the lessons, learning to live, learning to love this new reality. That is the dream. And that is the days of our lives are slowly passing by like this, day after day after day. And we're walking like zombies. We see these dream figures, these stick figures, these skeletons with clothing on, walking around, doing their things every single day, everywhere. It's all a hypothetical scenario. Hypothetical scenario we're imagining. And the power of our imagination is so great because it's really the power of the mind. And the mind is the servant of spirit and presents the ideas that spirit chooses. And spirit chose the idea of wanting to be prime creator and thus wanting reality to be changed. So spirit, mind presents this to spirit in the form of a hypothetical scenario of imagination of this could be the new reality and this could be the way that we can adapt to it. We need to practice adapting to it. So when reality does change, we will know all about this new reality and already be able to know exactly how to function in it. Exactly how to function in this new reality. But the fact is, reality will not ever change. There is no power that can change reality. Not even our own desire, our own will that it change is enough to change it. It's set, permanently set by the Prime Creator. So all of this dream, this hypothetical scenario that we are watching, sometimes in fast motion, sometimes in slow motion, it's all completely unnecessary. And if we just slow down enough, so we're not frantically trying to generate some sort of learning, some type of results in existence, some type of adaptation to the world, some way of learning how to love everything that's going on here. If we just slow down and take a moment, instead of being so frantically engaged in distraction, distracting ourselves and pushing for some sort of results, we might ask ourselves, what's going on here? Let me just observe, let my mind quiet down. Let me, instead of focusing on results, let me focus on the bigger picture. What are these results intended for? What is the purpose of all this? Let us not be so fixated on results. Let us just watch the show slowly drift by us. And let our mind focus somewhere else other than on the action, the activity, the taking in of results. Let everything slow down. Let your life slow down. Let your mind slow down. Where are we all going to? What is this dream about? What is the situation really about? And listen. Just listen. Listen for an answer. Ask yourself, I'd like to have a different perspective on this hypothetical scenario that I'm engaged with. Why am I engaged with it? What's the nature of my engagement with it? What is really taking place here? What are we really doing here? I'd like to get a different perspective. I'd like to get a fresh perspective. New perspective. Let it be fresh. Let it be clear. Let it be accurate. Let it be factual. I want to know what's going on here because it's very strange here. It's very weird here. I feel vulnerable. I feel threatened. And I don't feel like I should be feeling those feelings. These feelings are weird. And then the answer says, ah, but these are the kind of feelings that we expect to be feeling in a changed reality, you see. And then you say, aha. So really, this is just an imaginary hypothetical scenario of the presuming that the reality is going to change, and this is the new reality, the way that reality is going to be configured as it, once it gets changed into something totally different than reality really is right now. And so we're all trying to figure out, we're trying to get a sense of how to abide in this changed reality. Everything's impermanent. Everything's vulnerable. Everything's threatened. We're trying to learn how to love it, how to function in it, how to be in it. And the reason why everybody seems to have sort of a frown on their face and be preoccupied is they can't get it yet. They haven't gotten it yet. They haven't gotten the answer. They haven't figured it out. They're not happy. They don't feel as though they're abiding in it. Why? Because they cannot. You cannot learn to love this dream, this hypothetical scenario of a changed reality. You cannot learn to adapt to a changed reality because we still are what we are in reality. We haven't changed. Reality hasn't changed. We love reality. We function flawlessly in reality. That's our home. And the fact is, reality will never change. And so all of this moving about that we're doing is a complete waste of time. It has absolutely no meaning whatsoever. None. If we feel like, hey, all of this, what's going on in the world seems so meaningless to me. Sometimes you'll have that feeling, it all seems so meaningless. Well, instead of recoiling from that, say, maybe it is meaningless. Maybe it is. And instead of stopping where the nihilists have stopped saying, yeah, it's all meaningless, ask, why is it meaningless? And the answer will come, because it's a hypothetical scenario trying to adapt to a change in reality when in fact reality will never change. So therefore there's no application to all this learning and adaptation that we're doing. No application whatsoever. None. That's why it's meaningless. No relevance. We're preparing for something that will never happen. How can that be relevant? We're preparing for reality to be changed. Reality will never be changed. So how can it be any of this be relevant? It's not relevant. It has no internal reference. It's merely hypothetical. It hasn't happened yet. So this is like play acting. It's a pretense. It's all a pretense. It's all a pretending. It's all a preparation. So we feel this feeling like it hasn't happened yet. Something hasn't happened yet. And we're waiting for it to happen. We're waiting for this happening. It hasn't happened yet. And it will never happen. It will never happen. So we don't need to wait for what will never happen, do we? No, we don't. And waiting for what will never happen is what? It's not very wise. Kind of ridiculous. wonderful video. And just slow down a little bit. Just slow down a little bit. Just a little bit. Live your life in a little bit more like a slow motion mode. Just not going anywhere so fast, so frantically. As you move, as you do things, be what's called mindful. Being mindful just means to slow down. It's a way of slowing down. And when you slow down, you're not so frantically being attached to results, not pursuing them so frantically. And when you do that, you can start listening. You can start asking questions and listening. And when you get the answer, when you start listening, you realize there is an answer to this. There is an answer. All these questions that you've had, there is an answer to them. There is an answer. And you have to hear it. You have to realize it yourself. But you need to slow down. Just slow down. Live your life in slight slow motion mode from now on. All right. Very great. That's it for this one.